So this is the second part of this end time revival. We're talking about the 144,000, when they're going to be sealed in. How will they know? How will they know? And really, how will the Gentiles who come to Christ, you know, shortly thereafter, how will they know that they've been sealed by the Holy Spirit? Well, this is where we need to actually go back to some Old Testament allusions to find out how this works. So the first example that we can look at is actually the Elijah-Elisha type. And I've talked about this in other videos as well, that Elijah was caught up to God, caught up to heaven alive in a fiery chariot. And you'll remember the stories told in 2 Kings chapter 2. And Elisha was accompanying Elijah on a farewell journey, visiting the sons of the prophets, and kind of like Elijah was kept trying to sort of ditch Elisha, but Elisha wouldn't leave. And finally, Elijah says to Elisha, "What do you want?" And Elisha says, "I want the double portion of your spirit." So what Elisha was asking for basically was the birthright. He said, "I want the double portion. I want to be your son. I want to inherit what you have." And Elijah said, "Well, I can't give that to you. I can't guarantee you that. But here's the deal. If you see me leave when I'm caught up to heaven, then you'll have what you asked for." So they went on walking. They went to the Jordan River. Elijah used his cloak and parted the river. They walked through on the other side. And then a fiery chariot came between them and took Elijah away. And as he was going into heaven, his mantle fell. And then Elisha picked up this mantle. He walked over to the Jordan River and he said, "Where is the God of Elijah?" And the river parted just like it had done with Elijah. So Elisha knew that he had the double portion at that point. He knew that he he'd inherited the ministry that had belonged to Elijah. So this is a type of what's going to be happening during the end times. So there's going to be basically the passing of the mantle or passing the baton. And the group who is going to be taking over, the Elisha group, they need to see the Elijah group leave. And that's what's going to happen. The 144,000 who are the next group of people who are going to be proclaiming the gospel, they will see when we're raptured, when we're caught up, they're going to see it, okay? So that's the first way that they are going to know, is that they will see us leave. And the 144,000 who are aware that that's part of the promise here, when they see us leave, they're going to get the double portion. And the way this was confirmed in the life of Elisha was the fact that he was able to do the same miracle, okay? And that was the miracle of the parting of the Jordan. So I think one of the things that this group of people who receive the Holy Spirit after we leave, the 144,000, I think that they will be able to do miracles. So the first apostles, the first disciples of Jesus who were later made into the apostles who were sent out, they performed signs that authenticated their apostleship. And I think that the 144,000 are going to be able to do some of these same miracles as well. Perhaps not every single one of them, but I believe a lot of them will. So that'll be part of what's going on during the end times, is the working of miracles the way it happened in the early church. Okay, so the second example are the 70 elders. Right, so in the time of Moses, they're wandering in the wilderness and work got a little heavy for Moses. And so God said, "Choose 70 of the elders of the people, and I'm going to take some of the spirit that's on you and put it on them. And then they can help you do a spirit-filled, spirit-led ministry." So what happened was on an assigned day, the elders went to the tabernacle. The cloud of glory came down, and the spirit that was on Moses, which is the Spirit of God, came on these 70 men. Now, not all 70 of them had showed up. I don't know if they took roll call or not, but two of them weren't there. And there were two men by the name of Eldad and Medad, who have interesting meanings to their names. Eldad means beloved of God, and Medad just means beloved. So both of these men have the the idea with them that they're beloved and that they're loved by God. Anyway, they're just hanging out at home or doing whatever, and all of a sudden, the Spirit of God comes on them too, as evidenced by the fact that they start prophesying. And there are people in the camp who hear this and they're shocked because they've never heard anybody do this before except for Moses and perhaps Miriam. A guy runs to tell Joshua, who was Moses' servant, look, there's people prophesying in the camp. And then Joshua gets all like offended and, you know, should we tell them to stop? You know, and Moses said, no, don't tell them to stop. Would that all of God's people could prophesy. So there's a couple of things that we learn from this little passage in Numbers chapter 11. And the first thing is that it doesn't matter where you are, the Holy Spirit will find you. The Holy Spirit knows where we are. And the Holy Spirit will know where these people are too. Okay, so it doesn't matter that they're scattered throughout the world. When the Spirit comes, he knows the ones that he's chosen. And really, that's part of the deal with the 144,000. They are chosen. Just like with the 12 apostles, they were chosen. Now, they had to confirm that call. They had to self-select to continue on as first fruits or firstborn. And they had to continue all the way to the end. Judas didn't make it, but the rest of them did. And the 144,000 will need to do that too. But God knows those people who are his. And the second thing is that there is a specific number. Okay, in this case, there's 70. He knows how many positions he wants to fill. He wants to fill 70. He knows how many positions he wants to fill with the 144,000. This is a symbolic number, but basically what it's telling us is that God knows how many people he wants in this group. And he's chosen some people, but if they don't, you know, make it, there's always someone who will fill in the void. Just like when Judas, lost his ministry, he left it, he abandoned it, he betrayed Christ. There was someone who needed to fill in. So the disciples in Acts chapter 1, I believe that they cast lots to determine that Matthias should be the 12th apostle. And then I believe God, that the Lord Jesus actually chose Paul. Important thing, though, isn't the exact number. The important thing is that there is this group, and there will everybody that's supposed to be there will be there, or there will be a replacement. And that's kind of an important thing, too. The other thing is they knew that they had the Spirit, and then that they began to prophesy. And to prophesy means you just speak for God. Okay, so they began to praise God, just like the people in the book of Acts did. They were telling the glories of God and the wonders of his works and giving thanks to him. So there was this very spirit-filled, prophetic utterance that was coming forth from the 70 elders. Now it says that they never did it after this. They only did it that one time. They never did it again. But I believe that the 144,000 will continue to have this ministry. All right. There is also the Joel chapter 2 passage. And Joel chapter 2 says, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. So there'll be prophecy happening, there'll be dreams and visions. And it says, even upon the men servants and the maid servants in those days, I will pour out my Spirit. So we have the dreams and the visions, and it's on everybody. This will happen not only with the 144,000, but also with all the Gentiles who come to Christ on what I call the eighth day baptism. They're baptized in the Spirit on the eighth day, and all of these things will be part of what they will be part of the evidence that they've been filled with the Holy Spirit. A lot of people will look at these kind of prophetic types, and they know that this applies to people who get saved during the end times. And so they'll say things like, you know, the Holy Spirit will come on the 144,000 the way that he did in the Old Testament days. And that's true. That, I think, is the pattern for how this happens. But all that is a pattern. And because they view it like that, they believe that the Holy Spirit can come on people for ministry and then depart. And that's like what happened during the time of the judges, when the Holy Spirit would come on somebody and they would all of a sudden have power, or they would have, you know, some kind of evidence that the Holy Spirit was with them, enable them to do these miraculous things, or these things that normally shouldn't happen, you know, like Samson being able to tear apart a lion and, you know, fight off, you know, large groups of men and bring down the house, literally. These are things that only the Spirit can cause people to be able to do. And then when people sort of left walking with the Lord, like what happened with Samson, he gave up his secret, was in his hair that had never been cut. Well, the Spirit left him. And then when the people came on Samson, he thought he was going to be able to rescue himself, but he didn't know that the Lord had left him. So in that sense, in the Old Testament, the Spirit of God would leave people. And the role that the Spirit had then was different than how than the role that he has since the time of Christ's death. When Christ died and resurrected and ascended into heaven, he sent the Spirit not just to empower Christians, but to change them, okay, to transform them. And that was not a ministry that he could have. The Spirit could not have that same ministry until Christ came and basically opened the way for that one to happen. So the Holy Spirit did not have a sanctifying ministry, or he didn't reproduce the life of Christ inside of people who had the Spirit back in the Old Testament. But he does do that now. And so the 144,000, they're going to have the Spirit come on them in these kinds of similar ways, but the Holy Spirit is working a work in their life to conform them to the image of Christ, which is a sanctifying work which could not have happened in the Old Testament days. Now there's another Old Testament character that I just want to mention, and that's Saul. And let's see if I can find room for him up here. And he was the first king of Israel. And in 1 Samuel chapter 10, verses 5 through 11, basically Samuel is telling Saul, look, God's chosen you to be the king here, and this is going to be the sign that this is true. You're going to have these various things happen to you on your way home as you're walking down the road. And one of them is that you're going to meet up with a band of prophets who are singing and prophesying, and you will too. So let's just take a look at that really quick. It's just a really interesting passage, 1 Samuel 10. So this is what Samuel says. You shall go from there and come to the Oak of Tabor, and three men going up to God at Bethel will meet you there, one carrying three kids, another carrying three loaves of bread, and another carrying a skin of wine. And they'll greet you, and they'll give you two loaves of bread, which you shall accept from their hand. And after that, you shall come to Gibeath Elohim, where there is a garrison of the Philistines. And there, as you come to the city, you will meet a band of prophets coming down from the high place with harp, tambourine, flute, and lyre before them, prophesying. And then the Spirit of the Lord will come mightily upon you, and you shall prophesy with them and be turned into another man. Now when these signs meet you, do whatever your hand finds to do, for God is with you. And then down verse 9, and when he turned his back to leave Samuel, God gave him another heart, and all these signs came to pass that day. So one of the things that the Spirit does is it will give you another heart, okay? So it will give you another heart. And some people may not, you know, be able to do the miracles. They may not prophesy. They may not have dreams and visions, but they will have another heart. They're going to be filled with the Spirit and changed and transformed. They will be different. They'll have another heart. And the Lord says that in the last days that he'd take out their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. And the Holy Spirit does that, of course, with each one of us when he comes into our lives. He trades out our heart of stone and he gives us a heart of flesh. He gives us a new reason for living. He gives us new perspective, a life that's like his life. His role is to transform us from the inside out, and that's what the Holy Spirit does. Now, some of these people, like Samson and Saul, they did not continue on. They didn't persevere. In the very end, Samson did repent, and he asked that the Lord would fill him with the Spirit one more time so he could destroy the Philistines, and the Lord did that. Now, with Saul, the Holy Spirit left him because of rebellion. And Saul knew that the Spirit had left him. In fact, that Spirit was then replaced by a tormenting spirit that David would come and sing and play, and then that spirit would leave because the spirit inside of David was driving away that other dark spirit. But, you know, that's not going to be something that will happen to the 144,000. They cannot lose the Spirit of God. The letters to the seven churches are written to the 144,000 so that they can keep their birthright. So anything we read about in the letters to the seven churches that are warnings are really important, not so that the Holy Spirit won't leave them, but so that they can inherit the birthright. Some of these people will not inherit the double portion. That doesn't mean that they're not saved. They still are, but they, rather than being taken in a rapture right around the midpoint, they will have to endure during the reign of the beast and be taken in the third rapture, which is just prior to the day of the Lord. And some of the people, some of the 144,000 who could have been the 144,000, but who won't be, they will regret what they gave up. It will be sad for them. Like Esau, they will cry and beg, please, can I have the birthright back? And it won't. They will have lost it. You don't get to recover that. And the only way these people can lose their salvation would be to take the mark of the beast during the 3.5 year time when the reign of the beast is going on. So anyway, these are the ways that the 144,000 and the Gentiles who come to Christ are going to know. Number one, they're going to see us leave, and that's the first sign. Some of them may actually do the miracles like the early apostles did and like some of the miracles that are being done in the world today. You know, we don't see a lot of that here in the States, but it does happen in other countries. The Holy Spirit knows where we are. So he knows where the 144,000 are going to live. He knows where the saved Gentiles are going to be. He's going to be able to give the Spirit to everybody that he's called. And he does have a specific number in mind for the 144,000. These people, when they come to Christ, will also prophesy. And then Joel also tells us that people will have dreams and visions and prophesy. The Spirit will be poured out on all flesh. And anybody who wants to drink from that river of living water that can well up inside of them will be able to do that. So let me know what you think about this video, and we'll see you on another video. Till then, have a blessed day.